Thanks, Brooke. As further evidence that there is affirmative action is that the University of Texas History Department allowed this conservative to earn a doctorate. I thought it was because I was smart. Years later, my dissertation advisor said, no, you're really that conservative. We were trying to get rid of you. Well, once again, we're grateful for all of you attending. Brooke asked me to take a few minutes to explain why Michelle and I decided to move back to Texas. The first reason is really simple. When we left Texas for job opportunities, we knew that we were coming back. And so to be back at TPPF, which really is as great as you think it might be from the outside, because of the people who are there, has been a great privilege. But I thought I would take 3 or 4 minutes to explain a few stories that exemplify Lone Star Liberty working for Michelle and me after we left Texas for the first time. The first is, I went out as a history professor at a state university, and I will sum up my experience in higher education this way. Whatever you think about liberalism and higher education, triple, and that would be the truth. And I remember when President Reagan died, my department offered to do a symposium on Reagan's legacy. And I was a tenure-track professor, but not yet tenured. So those of you who are in higher ed know I was in a position of risk. And I signed up and said, I'll go speak about Reagan very favorably. Well, I was outnumbered 5-1. So I went and found a friend who was an economist and said, Randy, would you please join me for this symposium? He said, man, we're gonna go down together. And now that it was 5-2, the symposium was canceled. And that told me that as much as I love teaching young people, that maybe I needed to be involved in public policy work. Thank you. Secondly, the next two stories are about people, not me. One of them is an African-American mother in Lafayette, Louisiana, who is struggling like so many Americans do to make ends meet. And the Louisiana legislature had the foresight under Governor Jindal's leadership to pass school choice. It ended up being an imperfect program, but it was a desire to help people out. And so our school, John Paul Academy, participated because of what we saw as our Christian obligation. We didn't have to do that, but we decided to do that. We wanted to help people out. And 1 month into this new program, this African-American mother came up to me with tears in her eyes. I was working the pickup line at the end of the day. And she said, Kevin, this school and its decision to participate in school choice has changed my son's life. She was crying at that point. I was crying, as you can imagine. And I said, you're welcome. And she said, but it's more than that. This decision to participate in this program has changed my life and the lives of every one of our family members who will come after us. And for positive reasons, edging into public policy, I thought it was time to do something else. And so when I was president of Wyoming Catholic College, it was clear to us we should not receive federal money because of strings attached. We led the fight to reject that. The New York Times came to our campus. They met with me. They said, there's got to be a deeper story. We're gonna unearth the deeper story. I said, you can meet with any student you want. And the headline of that article was Cowboy Catholics. So I said, we'll take that reputation all day long. But one of the dads, I'll just close with this, one of the dads of a student there wrote to me and he said, Kevin, it is very hard to send our daughter to a college where there are no federal student loans. It costs us more money. But I've taken a second job because the courage of convictions is something I want my children to know. And I'll sum up my comments by saying the courage of convictions is why I am so privileged to be at the Texas Public Policy Foundation. Under Brooke's leadership and Arlene's great work and the talented 65 people who labor in the vineyards of liberty, it is really a privilege to see what we've done and what we're going to do. And so I very genuinely thank you, particularly those of you who are members of the legislature. Being at our service, I want you to know that at TPPF, we really do believe that we serve the people of Texas and we want to be at your service during this session and beyond. So thank you very much for being here. It's a great pleasure, therefore, to introduce someone who personifies our goal at TPPF, which is to be cheerful warriors. And that, of course, is our friend known as the Tweeter Laureate of Texas, Justice Don Willett. He's devoted his life to public service, serving as counsel to the Texas Attorney General, Texas Governor, U.S. Attorney General, and President of the United States, where from 2001 to 2002, he was special assistant to the President in the White House, advising President Bush on religious liberty and other domestic policy issues. Perhaps the greatest thing that I can say about Justice Don Willett is that right now commences the greatest speech in the history of the world. Justice Willett.
Thank you all for coming. I appreciate it. Kevin, thanks. Wow, that was a great, that was a thunderous ovation. I mean, we obscure judges, gosh, we are kind of fuddy-duddy, and we're more accustomed to like a polite smattering of applause. So that was kind of a bucket list thunderous ovation. Thank you for that. It was a lot kinder and a lot gentler than one I received many years ago. I was speaking to a Rotary Club, and the treasurer was tasked with doing my introduction. And he initially did all the normal bio stuff, where I grew up, where I went to school, jobs I've held. And then he made a really weird segue into how they really needed to raise the membership dues at the Rotary Club. And you could hear all these penny-pinching Rotarians getting pretty riled up and kind of moaning and groaning. And finally, the treasurer, he really got fed up with all the belly aching, and he slammed the podium and said, "Fine. But if we don't raise those dues, guys, we're never, never going to get any good speakers around here." And then he looked at me, and true story, as far as you know, that's a true story. Kevin, thank you for the intro. The lieutenant governor yesterday did not do me any favors. He's kind of my setup man, I guess, my hype man. Today's going to be the greatest speech in the history of the world. It'll be JFK and MLK and Pericles and Mark Antony all rolled into one. Respectfully, the lieutenant governor misspoke. But I will tell you this, I promise you, this speech today, we will make history. This will be hands down, of all the speeches I've ever given, this will be the most recent. So, thank you very much. Kevin did omit one critical thing from my bio. My Aunt Lynn, my mom's baby sister, here's Aunt Lynn, she was friends with Elvis, if you can believe that. But I learned early, never ask Aunt Lynn about her time with the king. She gets all shook up. So, thank you very much. Thank you. I am proud to have with me today my gold star father-in-law, Skip Mahaffey, a proud U.S. Marine Corps veteran. He is called Cappy by the Wee Willets. Two notable events from his U.S. Marine Corps service during Vietnam. True story, he went to boot camp with James Carville. Bless his heart. And when he was a embassy guard at the American Embassy in Paris, he was once pinched on the bottom by Jackie Onassis. Goosed by Jackie O. That sounds like a great title to like a Hallmark movie, right? It was incredible. I'm also thrilled that my wife, the astonishing Tiffany Willett, is able to join me today. Stand up. Now, many of you know what a jewel my wife Tiffany is. I will say, I don't want to brag, but I will say she gets pretty weak in the knees when I break out the lawyer talk, okay? So I once sent her, Senator Burton, you okay? I once sent her this flirty tweet. I said, "Hey girl, are you the Constitution? Because I'm sworn to preserve, protect, and defend you." Valentine's Day is coming up, so I had this card made. I'll reveal it today. hey, baby, are you a classy misdemeanor? Because you've got fine written all over. I'll sleep with one eye open tonight. I want to keep my remarks mercifully short. I used to work for Governor Abbott, and I was once about to get up and speak, and he leaned over and whispered, remember this beatitude. Blessed are the brief, for they shall be reelected. So, okay, this week is policy orientation, and you're hearing a lot of smart people debate issues facing our state, but frankly, policy orientation, it presumes civic orientation, right? Knowing how government works. And on that score, most Americans are pretty disoriented. Now, I admit, when I was growing up, I didn't have a lot of sophistication. I grew up in a small town, unbelievably small. In fact, Senator Taylor, my town was so small. Thank you, sir. Our town square only had three sides to it. That passes for humor at the Supreme Court. Our zip code truly began with a decimal. Can you believe that? All right. Okay, neither of my parents finished high school, okay? So college and then law school was a time of really rich enlightenment for me, really eye-opening. But if you fast forward to 2017, we inhabit today an age of staggering civic illiteracy. I'll give you two examples. There was a recent survey last year that found the percent of American adults who can correctly name all three branches of government, a whopping 26%. It gets worse. The percent of American adults who cannot correctly name one branch of government, almost a third, 31%. More people can name all three American Idol judges than one member of the U.S. Supreme Court. Not long ago, somebody was on one of the Sunday morning talk shows and said, we have three branches of government. We have a House, and we have a Senate, and we have a president. The poor judiciary, my branch, the most elegant branch. That's right. What my seven-year-old daughter calls the branch with the costumes, right? We're sort of the Rodney Dangerfield of all the branches. Judge Judy, bless her heart, she turns 75 later this year. 10% of American college graduates believe Judge Judy serves on the U.S. Supreme Court. Now, she also makes $47 million a year. And she tapes 52 days a year. Or as my 12-year-old mathematician son put it, Daddy, she makes more in one day of filming than you make in your entire six-year term. Thanks, buddy. Now, it is one thing not to know a lot of dry, you know, trivia, you know, factoids like the year the Constitution was signed, which of course, as you all know, was 1787. Thank you very much. But it is really petrifying that so many of our fellow citizens, they flub even the most foundational concepts like separation of powers and checks and balances. You all have heard the story. 1787, the Constitutional Convention has wrapped up. A woman rushes up to Ben Franklin as he's exiting Independence Hall. Well, doctor, what have we got, a republic or a monarchy? And Dr. Franklin famously replied, a republic if you can keep it, if you can keep it. Franklin knew. He knew the most vital ingredient for our new republic to thrive and survive was an engaged citizenry. What are the first three words of the Constitution in the preamble? We the people. It's not we the government, not we the pollsters, not we the subjects, not we the anything else. It's we the people. Justice Brandeis, long ago on the U.S. Supreme Court, said the only title in our democracy superior to that of president is that of that of citizen. Ultimate authority rests with us, meaning our government is only going to be as great, only going to be as responsive as we demand it to be. You know, they say everything is bigger in Texas, right? But not when it comes to our political participation. I don't know if you can see these numbers, but according to the Texas Civic Health Index, looking at the 2010 midterm election, Texas ranked 42nd in voter registration, 44th in discussing politics with others, 49th in contacting or visiting public officials, and dead last in voter turnout, even behind Washington, D.C. Now, to me, shouting, "We're number 51," doesn't sound very Texan, right? And when voters don't actually vote, then politicians have every incentive to ignore them. And it gets worse. By every measure of civic engagement, young Texans, ages 18 to 29, they lag significantly behind their already disconnected elders. Voter registration, way down. Voter turnout, way down. The only area, the one and only area where younger people hold a slight edge is expressing their opinions on the internet. Shocking. And it's maybe that civic deficit among young people that explains why so many students, traumatized by the election last November, wanted schools to cancel exams, to cancel class. Cornell University in the Ivy League had a cry-in. Students at Michigan were offered coloring books. At Yale Law School, some professors agreed to stop calling on students for the rest of the semester. On Capitol Hill, some therapy dogs were brought in to comfort some panic-stricken students who, it looks like, they're live-tweeting their distress. I don't know. Get this, the overwhelming majority of America's elite universities, they no longer require history majors to take a single course in American history, which explains why less than half of college graduates know that George Washington was the commanding general at Yorktown. This includes graduates of George Washington University. We have to get back into the civic education game. We've got to educate young Texans about our constitutional heritage. Our founders, they were imperfect, but they were inspired, they were brilliant. And as they designed America, they really hit the trifecta, in my view. They had hindsight, and they had insight, and they had foresight. Hindsight. Our framers knew, personally, painfully, the history of kings and dictators. And that's precisely why they wrote Article 2, Section 3, the Take Care Clause, into the Constitution. It imposes a solemn duty of every president of every party to, quote, take care that the laws be faithfully executed. The Take Care Clause was enacted to curb imperial inclinations and to make clear that American presidents were not going to be like English kings, who could suspend laws, who could play favorites with picking and choosing to whom laws were going to apply. Our president swears an oath to the Constitution, an oath enshrined in the Constitution itself. Article 2, Section 1, Clause 8, to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution. All of it, not snippets of it, not just the parts you like, not just the odd-numbered amendments. And that oath comes first, always, not your party, and not your politics, and not your poll numbers. It doesn't fall to one person to decide unilaterally by fiat which laws you're going to follow, in which to ignore, in which to rewrite, in which to invent. As Ben As Ben Franklin famously said, the Constitution is not Starbucks. Yeah, I'm paraphrasing. The point being, at Starbucks, you can order your venti, pumpkin spice, non-fat, no-fum, hazelnut macchiato with caramel drizzle, right? With the Constitution, there's not a non-fat, decaffeinated Second Amendment. I mean, it says what it says. Our Constitution, the Constitution doesn't have one of these. There's no easy button to dispense with the rule of law. And indeed, that was the entire point, to create a government not of man, but of laws. It was radical. And the old world monarchists and aristocrats hated it. So our framers had hindsight, rejecting royal absolutism through the Take Care Clause. So enshrining in the Constitution itself this duty of faithful enforcement. Our framers also had insight. How many times does the word democracy appear in the Constitution? Zero. How about the Declaration of Independence? Zero. The framers were committed to an audacious idea. Liberty is not provided by government. Liberty pre-exists government. It is not a gift from the sovereign. It is our natural birthright. Democracy, Franklin reportedly said, is two wolves and a lamb voting on what to have for lunch, and liberty is a well-armed lamb contesting the vote. So as Jefferson wrote in the Declaration, we are endowed with certain unalienable rights. By whom? By our Creator. They are fixed. They are innate. They are unalienable. They are ours by virtue of our very humanity. So they're not a mere luxury to be enjoyed at the sufferance of governmental grace. They are indispensable to human dignity and prosperity. So, contrary to popular belief, our brilliant founders crafted our Constitution, dividing power the way they did, not to enshrine a process, democracy, but to enshrine a promise of liberty, individual freedom, the essential condition of human flourishing. So our founders had hindsight, insight, and foresight. Hindsight, government of laws, not of men. Insight, government exists to secure the blessings of liberty. And finally, foresight, to safeguard liberty, you've got to structure government to control its power. So our enlightened founders, they pledged their lives, their fortunes, their sacred honors to birth a new type of nation. Our revolution produced a revolutionary design, three separate co-equal branches. Ambition, checking ambition. Three rival branches, deriving power from three unrivaled words, we the people. You know, I've long thought that this guy, Isaac Newton, should be an honorary founding father. So yes, he was British, I get that. And yes, he died before James Madison, the father of the Constitution, was even born. But first of all, look at that hair. It's like magnificent. The more hair I lose, the more I want to bring back the powdered wigs to the judiciary, right? But second, more important, our Constitution's Madisonian architecture is infused with Newtonian genius, three rival branches locked in synchronous orbit by competing interest. So Newton's third law of motion, for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction, it's a physical law, but it's also a political law. It's a law of constitutional motion, that when one body, when one branch of government exerts a force upon another, the second body exerts or should exert an equal and opposite force. The founders, they weren't content to kind of tinker around the edges. They upended things and they adopted a radical structure that divided power in order to control power. Why? Because, as Madison wrote in Federalist 51, men are not angels. And unfettered power can only weaken personal liberty and never strengthen it. So to curb collective power, the founders tried to harness individual power, leveraging personal ambition, enabling every branch to counteract manipulation by the other branches. And our liberties are further protected by having power divided vertically between the federal and state governments. Here's a recent tweet of mine. Madison wrote in Federalist 45 that federal powers must be, quote, few and defined, while state powers must be, quote, numerous and indefinite. We still need to work on that part, right, Senator?
Yes.
A little bit. So here's some Texas trivia for you. James Madison, the father of the Constitution, he turned 85 years old on the day that the Republic of Texas adopted its Constitution in 1836. And Madison lived barely 100 days more, just barely long enough to see Texas free. So hindsight, insight, foresight, is handiwork that has held for almost 230 years, making America the oldest democratic republic on earth. So this Constitution is an exquisite charter of freedom, and it requires fierce champions, you know, not feeble spectators, and never more so than today. You know, we inhabit constitutionally consequential times. But as I began, one-third of American adults can't name even one branch of government. So how can we reverse these embarrassing statistics? I think we've got to strengthen civics education. I think civics is no less a core competency than other subjects. I mean, young people are utterly clueless about the basics of how our republic works. Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, since leaving the Supreme Court about 11, 12 years ago, has devoted her life to civic education, and she doesn't pull punches. Here's what she says. You know, the better educated our students are, the better prepared they'll be to preserve the system of government we have, and we've got to start with the education of our young people. Knowledge about our government is not handed down through the gene pool. Every generation has to learn it, and we've got some work to do. She's right. This is not something hardwired into our DNA. As Americans, the habits of citizenship have to be taught and learned anew by every generation, just as we have to teach and learn reading or math or a foreign language. You can't separate civic education from basic education. As President Reagan said, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, handed on for them to do the same. There was a recent study that examined the mission statements of the 100 largest public school systems in America. And the point of the study was to ask, you know, what exactly is our purpose here? And I always thought the purpose of public education, the public purpose of public education, was to equip children for citizenship and self-government. And that's what our founders thought, instilling civic values and preparing the next generation for thoughtful and capable self-government. When the U.S. Supreme Court ruled in Brown v. Board of Education that segregated schools were unconstitutional, the court stressed the importance of education as a crucible for good citizenship. And for many students, frankly, schools may be the only place where they're exposed to the American political tradition. 60% of the mission statements of the 100 largest public school districts in America never mention civics. They never mention citizenship. The words America and American never appear, not one time, in 100 mission statements. The crisis is pretty acute, but there are some promising signs. 9 states have recently passed laws requiring high school students to pass the U.S. citizenship exam before graduation. 100 multiple choice questions on basic facts about U.S. history and government. 92% of immigrants pass the exam on their first try. 92%. One of my proudest moments in public service came in 2002, preparing a presidential executive order after 9/11 to expedite citizenship for immigrants serving America in the armed forces. They passed the exam with a 92% passage rate. By contrast, less than 5% of high schoolers in Arizona and Oklahoma passed a similar test. So a recent survey asked Americans 10 questions from the test. I'll give you 3. 71% could not identify the Constitution as the supreme law of the land. 63% could not name one of their U.S. senators. And 62% could not identify the governor of their state. Young people need to be aggressively invited into the civic life of Texas, because research is that good habits formed when we're young, they stick with you through life. And you're more apt to vote, you're more apt to discuss politics at home, you're more likely to volunteer, you're more confident in public speaking and reaching out to your legislators. But you can't put knowledge to use if you don't have knowledge. And if you're uninformed, you're unengaged, and you're alienated. So next Monday, we're going to celebrate MLK Day. And one of my favorite King quotes is this one. You know, life's most persistent, urgent question is, what are you doing for others? Boosting the civic IQ of young Texans is going to require something from all of us in this room. This session, the legislature will consider some pretty smart proposals to champion civic education. And I urge our lawmakers to consider them very carefully. I don't believe in testing kids to death, but schools have a civic mission. And the data proves this is really a fish or cut bait moment. So when I was growing up in a drafty, double wide trailer out in the country surrounded by cotton and cattle, and the only robe I ever imagined wearing was maybe at graduation or maybe in church choir. I never ever, serving on the Supreme Court of Texas. My mom waited tables for 55 years. Here she is, mostly at the local truck stop along the interstate. My father had passed away when I was 6 years old. And my mom did what a lot of moms do, what a lot of your moms may have done. She, rolled her sleeves up. She hunkered down and worked her tail off and worked her heart out. And the night before I joined the Supreme Court, August 24th of 05, I found a website that will estimate the number of miles that people walk every day in different occupations. So you can imagine letter carrier, really high, waitress, really high, Supreme Court justice, really low. But I did the math, and I was astonished to discover in my mom's half century plus of waitressing, she had walked from the earth to the moon 250,000 miles. In Texas terms, put your finger in the corner of the panhandle up by Texline or Dalhart. Trace the border of our state 85 times. That's 250,000 miles.
So every working year of her life, my mom made a complete trip and a half around the border. So I was a 30-something father of one when I joined the court. That's the day I joined the court. That little guy there was 18 months old. He's going to turn 13 next month. I am now a newly 50 father of three. By the way, please pray for the one in the orange shirt. He has what we euphemistically call sparkle. I mean, his probation officer may have a different word for it one day. I don't know. So, 50-year-old father of three. My next campaign in 2018, I will be an early 50s father of... You ready? Should we tell him? Really? Three. Woo! Look, I revere the law. The law is a majestic thing. And when the people of our state, when all of you go to the polls, when you confer the title judge on somebody, and you really place in human hands that profound majesty, something that really impacts and hopefully enriches, you know, the life of every single Texan. A couple years ago, I was driving on Mopac. I was creeping on Mopac, and I saw someone who I really admire, because this person has found her niche in the world. Check this out. This woman is 100% in her element. Literally. And as you can tell, I am 100% behind her. The law's my element. And it is a magic combination to love what you do and believe that it matters, that it counts in a grand, divine, big picture way. So President Sam Houston, I think, was right. He said, an able, honest, enlightened judiciary should be the first object of every people. And honestly, it's a little weird that I turned out in this profession that I'm a judge, because I learned recently the name Willet is an ancient Gaelic word that means he who never legislates from the bench. It was my destiny. Look, judging is a sacred duty. And I confess, it is one for which I seek a lot of sacred guidance. Every time we go on to the bench at my court, as we did yesterday, as we did today, every time I walk up that ramp, every time I, before that final turn into the courtroom, I say a prayer every single time before every single case for wisdom and for discernment and really of bottomless gratitude for this unfathomable privilege I have of serving each of you and 27 million other Texans on our Supreme Court. So God bless you all, and thank you very much.
Justice Willet, I dare say that you met expectations. Another round of applause. Thank you. A couple of quick things before we break into some very good panels this afternoon. There are two things Justice Willet said that I think for us at the foundation are really important. Number one is the philosophical foundation on which our work rests. So each one of you in this room attending this orientation has an issue or two or five that you're really interested in. And while those policies intrinsically are important, really they flow out of a very long tradition of fighting for something Justice Willet reminded us of, which is the pre-existence of liberty before government. And we're so blessed. Yes, thank you for that reminder. And I'll say very genuinely, we're so blessed to be in a state where the majority of our legislature understands that and tries to act on that every day. So thanks again for your work, ladies and gentlemen. The second thing is something that's important to us at TPPF, which is modeling civil discourse. You know that we try to get multiple voices, multiple viewpoints here at the orientation, and you'll see that on tap this afternoon. We have panels on education, on regulation, on climate science, and we invite you to go there and participate. Feel free to disagree, air differences of opinion, but as I know those of you I've gotten to know well do, we want to model real civil discourse in that so that each of us can be better, each of us can model the virtue that our founders wanted to do, and Texas will continue to be a great place. Thanks for being here. God bless you, and God bless Texas.